Hello friends, welcome to this video. In this video, I am going to discuss the provisions relating to registration under GST. Any person who is in the business of supply of services or supply of goods may get registered under GST Act. Once a person, if he gets registered under the GST Act, from then on he has to charge tax in his supply, in his outward supply, and remit the taxes to the government. Registration under GST is mandatory once the turnover of the person crosses the threshold limit. However, if the turnover of the person is below the threshold limit, registration is still optional. The person can opt to get himself registered as well. Once the person register himself under GST, whatever the purchases he makes and the taxes he pays on the purchases, it will become available as input tax credit for the person. So in order to avail the input tax credit, it is mandatory for the person to get himself registered under GST Act. Let us now discuss the provisions relating to GST, the provisions of the GST Act, the provisions of GST rules, as well as the procedure to get to be followed for a person to get himself registered. The section deals with registration under GST is section 22. Section 22 subsection 1 of CGST Act 2017 prescribes the threshold limit for a person to get himself registered. Threshold limit is in terms of turnover. If the turnover of a person in the financial year, if it exceeds the following limits, then the person has to mandatorily get registered under GST Act. Let us now see what is the threshold limit. See, when the GST Act was initially implemented, that time the turnover limit was totally different. If you read the BAR Act, you will find that the turnover limit is prescribed as rupees 20 lakhs for any person who is into the business of both supply of goods as well as supply of services. There was a single threshold limit for both the types of services, both the types of supplies, that is goods and services, and 20 lakhs was the limit prescribed for other states. And rupees 10 lakhs, a concessional rate of rupees 10 lakhs turnover limit was prescribed for some specified states. However, the government has issued a notification. The notification number is notification 10/2017. That was issued on 7th of March 2017. And they have prescribed a revised threshold limit in terms of turnover for a person to get himself registered mandatorily. And the revised threshold limit is applicable from the date of 1st of April 2017. So you can divide the threshold limit into two categories. One is the threshold limit prescribed, which is applicable before 1st of April 2019. And turnover limit from 1st of April 2019. Okay, so the limit prescribed is, if a person is engaged in exclusively supply of goods, the person is a supplier of goods only, he does not have any business of supply of services. In that case, the threshold limit is rupees 40 lakhs for all the states, for all the persons who is into the business of exclusively supplying goods, the turnover limit is rupees 40 lakhs. However, a separate turnover limit is provided for certain states in India. If a person is registered under, conducting business in any of these states, then the turnover limit will not be 40 lakhs, it will be 20 lakhs. The states are Uttarakhand, Meghalaya, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Puducherry, that is Pondicherry, and Telangana. If a person is conducting business and supplying goods from these following states, then if the person crosses the limit of rupees 20 lakhs, then he has to get himself registered. So the rupees 40 lakhs threshold is not applicable for a person who is doing business in these states. And the concessional rate of rupees 10 lakhs still applicable for these four specific states. You can easily remember that these four states are almost north and towards the down east of the states. You can find these states in the eastern corner of India. Those four states are Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland and Tripura. These four states, the threshold limit for registration is rupees 10 lakhs only. So to summarize, there are three types of threshold limits provided for a person who is into supply of goods. So this threshold limit is only for a person who is exclusively supplying goods. So what is the threshold limit? Rupees 40 lakhs in general case, and rupees 20 lakhs in case of states Uttarakhand, Meghalaya, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Pondicherry and Telangana. That is rupees 20 lakhs, and rupees 10 lakhs for the person who's in states like Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland and Tripura. So this is the threshold limit for a person who is into exclusive supply of goods. And if a person is into supply of services, or a person is dealing into both, like supply of goods as well as supply of services, if a person falls in this category, then the threshold limit is rupees 20 lakhs for all the states except these four states, which we have seen that the eastern corner states, which we call it as Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland and Tripura. For these four states, the threshold limit is still 10 lakhs only. But for the rest of the states, the threshold limit is 20 lakhs for a person who is into supply of services or supply of both, supply of goods as well as services. Clear? So here there is no third threshold limit. So threshold limit provided for this category is only two, that is 20 lakhs and rupees 10 lakhs. Then supply of goods and supply of exempted services shall be treated as only supply of goods for application of threshold. There is a proviso under this section, this subsection. That proviso says that if a person is into supply of goods as well as supply of services, but the supply of services is exempted by government, that is a exempted services, so in that case that person would be considered as a person who is into exclusively supplying goods only. So the threshold limit applicable for a person who is into exclusive supply of goods will be applicable for those person as well, if a person is into supply of goods as well as exempted supply of services. So that is what the proviso says under this subsection. So next we are going to section 24. Directly we are now entering into section 24, because section 24 is very relevant for registration. I am going to list out certain category of persons, and the persons falling under these category has to mandatorily register under GST Act. There is no threshold limit, no applicable for these type of persons. So the person falling under these categories has to get mandatorily registered under GST Act, and there is no threshold limit. Even a single rupee of supply is liable to be get registered. So those persons are, there are, the list is 10 here. There are 10 types of persons here, and we are going to discuss each and every one of the category here. So the first category we are going to see is a person who is into supplying goods in the course of interstate, who is into interstate supplies. What is interstate supplies? That means supply of either goods or supply of services from one state to another. He is supplying from one state, and the goods, the destination of supply is into another state. That is called interstate or interstate supplies. So any person who is into interstate supplies has to mandatorily get registered under the Act. So the threshold limit will not be applicable for those persons. Clear? So that is first category. Second category is a casual taxable person making taxable supplies. casual taxable person, we will be discussing in our next slide, or who is called as casual taxable person. And if a person is registered as a casual taxable person, or a person who is doing who is supplying, that is liable to get registered as a casual taxable person, he has to mandatorily register. So for those persons, the threshold limit is not applicable. Then the third category is person who are required to pay taxes under RCM basis. The person who has to pay taxes under RCM basis. RCM we have already discussed under section 9, subsection 3, subsection 4 and subsection 5 as well. All the three subsections of section 9, those three subsections speak about taxes to be paid under RCM. So those persons has to mandatorily get registered under the GST Act. The threshold limit does not apply to those persons as well. Then the fourth category of person is non-resident taxable person making taxable supply. Any non-resident taxable person who is into making any taxable supplies, he has to get registered under the Act. Then the fifth category is a resident who has to deduct, a person who has to deduct TDS under the GST Act. A person who has to get, mandatorily deduct TDS, and he has to also get registered himself under the Act. Then the next person is a person who supplies taxable goods or services on behalf of any other persons, including an agent. A person who, if the person is supplying goods or services on behalf of any other person, for example, on behalf of his principal, he is supplying goods or services, including he be an agent, then he has to mandatorily get registered. Then the next category, the seventh category, is an ISD, Input Service Distributor. We already discussed who is called an Input Service Distributor. So an ISD also has to mandatorily get registered under the Act. There is no threshold limit for him. Then the eighth category is every e-commerce operator. Any e-commerce operator also has to get registered under the Act. Then the next category is ninth category is a supplier of OIDR services. Online information database access and retrieval services is called OIDR services. And if the person is supplying from outside India, and he is supplying to a person who is in India and other than a registered person, if an OIDR service provider is situated outside India, and supplier is supplying services to a person who is an unregistered person in India, so in that case the OIDR service person has to mandatorily get registered under the GST Act. So the threshold limit also will not apply to those persons. Then the 10th category of person is just a residual category, where the government has reserved a right to notify any other persons for whom also the threshold limit will not apply. This is like the such other person as notified by the government. If the government notifies any other person who has to mandatorily get registered under the Act without crossing the threshold limit, that will be notified by the empowerment provided by this section under this clause 10. So clear. So these 9 categories of person has to mandatorily get registered under the Act. Even the threshold, even the turnover limit, the turnover is within the threshold limit. So that is what provided under section 24. It is very important to note that the section starts with notwithstanding anything contained. That means what? It is starting with the non-abstante clause. Non-abstante clause means this section will ride over the any other section, any other contradicting section. We have already discussed this. If the section starts with the non-abstante clause, then this section will prevail over any other section which discusses in contradiction with the section, with this section. So this section has to give preference. If there are any contrary provisions available in any other section, that section should be ignored, or it should not be followed, at least for these categories of persons. Okay, so the next section now we are going to see is section 23. We already saw section 22 and section 24. Under section 22, section 22 gives the threshold limit for a person to get registered under GST. Section 24 says for these types of persons, the threshold limit will not be applicable. He has to mandatorily get registered under the GST Act. Then comes section 23. Under section 23, these persons are not liable to get registered. These persons are not liable to get registered at all. Who are those persons? The first clause, clause A, says a person who are exclusively supplying goods or services that are not at all taxable under the Act. We already discussed certain goods or services are not at all within the ambit of GST. They are not brought into the ambit of GST. For example, I can give you petroleum products or alcoholic liquor for human consumption. So these two products are not at all taxable under GST at all. They are not in within the ambit of GST. So a person who is supplier of these categories of goods are not liable to get registered. Even the threshold limit is more or less, no provisions of the Act will become applicable for them. Then the next person is a person who is into supply of goods or services which are exempted under the Act. See, exempted goods or services are notified by the government. Some goods or services might have been notified by the government as exempted. So for those persons the person who are into supply of those goods or those types of services need not get registered under the GST Act. So these provisions will not apply to those persons. Next clause, clause B, says any agriculturalist who are into supply of cultivations from land. An agriculturalist, supplying any cultivation that are taken out from land. So those person also need not get registered under the GST Act. That is subsection 1. Next subsection is subsection 2. Subsection 2 says that any person who are notified by government will also not get registered under the GST Act, or the provisions which we discussed in our earlier slides will not be directly applicable to them. If it is notified by the government, then whatever the notification says, that one, those provisions only will applicable for those persons. They will not be referring or falling under the provisions which we discussed in section 22 or section 24. So that is what provided under subsection 2. This means what? If government wants to include any person or wants to alter the provisions, applicability of provisions for any specific persons, then they can do so under this subsection by way of issuing a notification or a circular. So that is what provided under subsection 2. And till date, government has already issued certain notifications notifying certain categories of persons who are not required to get registered under the Act. Otherwise than by this notification, they have to get registered. So it means what? Because of this notification, the person will not get registered. Otherwise, those person will have to get registered under GST Act if this notification is not there. What is that notification? The first notification we are going to say is notification 7/2017, that is issued under Integrated Tax Act, that is IGST. It was issued on 14th of September 2017. And that notification was further amended by a notification number 2/2019 Integrated Tax, which was issued on 29th of January 2019. So there are two notifications here. And this what does this notification says? Any job workers who are into interstate supply of services. Job worker who are into interstate supply of services, we already saw under schedule 2, any supply provided by a job worker will be categorized as supply of services only. So the job work, whatever the supply made by job worker, it is called as supply of services only. It is never supply of goods. So it means what? Any job worker who are into supply of services, and that too in the nature of interstate supply of services, then then the person need not get registered. Then the person need not get registered under the Act. See, under Section 24, we saw that the first category of person is any person who are making supply in the course of interstate. Any person who are making supply in the course of interstate has to mandatorily get registered. There is no threshold limit applicable for those persons. That is what we have seen. If this notification is not there, job worker should have got registered himself under the Act because they are making interstate supply of services under Section 24. But because of this notification, there is a relief provided to those job workers who are into supply of services in the course of interstate. What does this notification say? A person crosses threshold limit or person takes voluntary registration. It means what? The person need not get registered except the following person, except person who have crossed the threshold limit. See, it says threshold limit is not applicable. From the day one they have to get registered, but because of this notification says threshold limit will be applicable for this type of job worker. So threshold limit for what? Supply of services. What is the threshold limit? It is 20 lakhs for normal states, and for specified states it is 10 lakhs. The job worker need not get registered himself until he crosses the threshold limit because of this notification. But if the job worker crosses the threshold limit, he has to mandatorily get registered. This notification will not apply to those type of job workers. So this notification will apply to persons who are below the threshold limit, whose turnover is below the threshold limit, and they are into supply of interstate services. And also this notification will not apply to job workers who have taken registration on a voluntary basis. See, still though the person, the Act does not mandate the job worker to get registered himself, but still the job worker has the option to get to take registration on a voluntary basis. That is first category. Second category is a person who are into supply of live poultry, species of Gallus domesticus, ducks, geese, turkeys and guinea fowls. So these types of persons are also not required to get registered if the supply is made in the course of interstate till the threshold limit is reached. The third category is jewelry, goldsmiths and silversmiths. See, these were all the categories that was removed by the amendment of notification. See, we saw that the earlier notification was amended by a further notification number 2/2019. So notification 2/2019 has removed this category of person. So this category of person, jewelry or goldsmiths, who were not required to register himself until the threshold limit till 29/1/2019. Once this notification has removed this person has to now mandatorily get registered, and if they are making any interstate supply. So are we clear or not with this notification? Next, there is a next notification number 10/2019 issued under integrated tax law. It was dated 13/10/2017. What does the notification say? Notification is applicable for a supplier of services only, interstate supplier of services. Because if the supply of services is within the state, then threshold limit is automatically applicable. If the supply of services is interstate, then because of Section 24 Clause 1, he has to mandatorily get registered. Threshold limit will not applicable. Because that is the reason the government wants to issue this notification. Because of this notification, any supplier of services, okay, who are into supplying in the course of interstate, then the threshold limit will become applicable for those person. So it means for those person also will not get registered up to the threshold limit of 20 lakhs rupees. So the turnover in this case has to be computed on all India basis. Not only in this case, for any case, for applicability of this threshold limit, the turnover has to be computed on all India basis. So that is what this notification number 10 says. Then there is another notification number 65/2017. It was issued under Central Tax Law, CGST Act. It was dated on 15/11/2017. This notification says e-commerce operator
who are required to collect taxes under Section 52 and who is into supply of services other than those provided under Section 9 subsection 5 are exempted to register if the threshold limit is not crossed. It means what? Any e-commerce operator into supply of we already saw that under Section 24 e-commerce operator has to mandatory get registered. It is, they have not told whether it is interstate or intrastate. Whatever the supply they provide, an e-commerce operator has to mandatory get registered. That is what provided under Section 24. But this notification says that any e-commerce operator who are not required to collect tax under Section 52. So TCS provisions, that is what under Section 52 says, TCS provision is not applicable for an e-commerce operator, and such e-commerce operator is also not supplying any services that was provided or notified under Section 95. We saw that any radio taxi, that is Ola, Uber services, or any restaurant, sorry, hotels or inns, reservation of any hotels or inns, like websites like Make My Trip, Go Ibibo, those type of services are already notified under Section 95. It means what? The tax has to be paid by e-commerce operator only, not by the supplier. That is somewhat called reverse charge mechanism. So if the services are not coming under those categories and the e-commerce operator is also not required to collect taxes under Section 52, then for such type of e-commerce operator, they are exempted to get registered until the threshold limit of turnover is crossed. Yeah, that is what this notification number 65 says. There is a next notification, notification number 56/2018. It was also issued under Central Tax CGST Act. It was dated on 23rd October 2018. This notification is applicable for person who is into supplying of handicraft goods. So any person who is into supply of handicraft goods and they are making any interstate supplies, the supply is made in the nature of interstate supplies, and they are liable to get registered as a casual taxable person. In those cases, for those suppliers, threshold limit will become applicable, so they need not get registered until the turnover has reached the threshold. Next category is any supply made by any craft person by hand or through machinery for certain specified products. There are certain specified goods or products provided under the notification. So if the supplier is providing those types of goods as a craftsman, then for those person also this turnover limit will become applicable. They need not get registered until their turnover has crossed the threshold limit. Now that is notification number 56/2018. So based on this, we have a question here to discuss. The question is, Mr. X, this question is similar, it is like an example in order to better understand the provisions which we have already discussed. Now Mr. X is a dealer who is in Andhra Pradesh dealing with intrastate supply of goods and services. They are into intrastate supply, it is not interstate, intrastate only, and has place of business in India. Furnish the following information relating to financial year 2019-20. Financial year 19-20, they have furnished the following information, and the place of business is in Andhra within India. What is the information? Sale of taxable goods by head office located in Chennai. The head office is located in Chennai, and head office has made certain sale of taxable goods up to rupees 1 lakh rupees. Supply of taxable services by branch office at Bangalore. So they have branch office at Bangalore. They have supplied goods services to the extent of rupees 50,000, and the supply of goods exempted goods to the extent rupees 10,000. And they have made certain export of goods and services, that is to the value of rupees 2 lakhs, and sale of goods acting as agent on behalf of principal. It means they have sold goods on behalf of another person, that is for 15 lakhs rupees. The question here is whether the person has to get registered, whether the threshold limit, turnover limit will become applicable. See, here the total turnover here is 15 lakhs plus 1 lakh, that is 16, 18. The total turnover the made by Mr. X is 18 lakhs and 60,000 rupees. Whether he has to get registered under GST, we will discuss one by one. Sale of taxable, in order to compute the turnover made in throughout the India has to be taken into account. That is what we have to have in mind now. So with that in our mind, we will now discuss the provisions. Sale of taxable goods by head office located in Chennai, whether that will be included. Yes, it will be included. Supply of taxable services by branch office, that will also be included. Supply of goods exempted from GST, that is rupees 10,000, that is also included. Export of goods and services rupees 2 lakhs, that will also be included. Sale of goods acting as an agent on behalf of principal, that is 15 lakhs. The total is 18 lakhs 60,000. What is the threshold here? The threshold here is 20 lakhs rupees. So here, whether they have crossed the 20 lakhs rupees? No, they have not crossed the 20 lakhs rupees. It is within the threshold limit. So registration is not mandatory here. Here the next question example here is a CMA Manish, an unregistered person, has place of profession in Bhubaneswar, Odisha. Sorry, who has place of business in Bhubaneswar, which is in Odisha. Supplies taxable services to Infosys Limited, a registered person in Bangalore. You have to answer the following. Is it interstate supply or intrastate supply? See, we will have to first understand, we in order to answer whether it is interstate supply or intrastate supply, we need to remember the provisions of place of provision of services. In the case of place of provision of services, under section 13, what does this say? Place of provision of any service should be the location of the recipient if the recipient is registered. If the recipient is not registered, then if the address of the recipient is available with the supplier, then the location of the recipient only. If both are not available, then the place of provision of service is the location of supplier. So here, location of the supplier is Bhubaneswar, Odisha. Location of recipient, whether he is registered, yes, Infosys Limited is registered under GST, and since the recipient is registered here, the place of provision of services is Bangalore. So Odisha to Bangalore is an interstate supply. So it means what? This is the nature of interstate supply only. Who is liable to pay GST here? Who is liable to pay GST? The recipient here is a registered person. It is not a supply made to an unregistered recipient. And they have given a note here that the turnover of Manish is 18 lakhs in the previous year. We have seen a notification number 10/2017 says any supplier who is in the nature of supply of services and that is made interstate, that is interstate nature of supply of services, until the threshold limit of rupees 20 lakhs, he may not get registered. So here the turnover limit is rupees 18 lakhs only in the previous year. That means it is not crossed the threshold limit. Manish is not liable to be registered at all. Since the Manish is an unregistered person and Infosys Limited is a registered person, the tax has to be paid under reverse charge mechanism. But however, reverse charge mechanism under this case has been removed also. That is the reason there will not be any tax at all for this case. Clear? Even RCM will not apply here, and Manish is also not required to get registered, so GST will not be applicable for these transactions. So clear? So next, what we are going to discuss is certain provisions or concept related to casual taxable person, because we saw this as clause 2 in section 24. Because a person who has registered himself as casual taxable person, or a person who has to by virtue of this provisions has to get mandatorily registered under this act, that's what they say, and the provisions of section 24 says. So now we will understand who is called as casual taxable person. Section 2 clause 20 of CGST act defines a casual taxable person. A casual taxable person means a person who undertakes supply occasionally he is not a regular supplier. He takes undertakes supply only on an occasional basis from a state or union territory where he has no fixed place of business. For example, I am a supplier. My fixed place of business is in Tamil Nadu, in Chennai, Tamil Nadu. I am going to make certain supplies in Andhra Pradesh. That supply which I am going to make is for a temporary period only. It is for one or two engagement. For that I am going to make a supply there in Andhra Pradesh. It means what? I do not have any fixed place of business in Andhra Pradesh. So I have a registration in Tamil Nadu. Already I am registered person in Tamil Nadu, and I am going to undertake supply in Andhra Pradesh. So in that case, what I am going to do, I have to register myself as a casual taxable person in Andhra Pradesh, because I do not supply frequently to Andhra Pradesh, and I supply only on an occasional basis. So what this the act says, they have to compulsorily register under GST Act, and they cannot even opt for a composition levy. Then when the person has to register himself as a casual taxable person, the tax liability that is to be the liability to be arised for the taxes on the supply he is going to make in the another state. For in my example, whatever the supply I am going to make in Andhra Pradesh, whatever the tax liability will come on those supply, I have to ascertain the tax liability in advance, and I have to make payment of that taxes as an advance tax payment. Then only I can apply for a registration as a casual taxable person. So for a person who to get registered as a casual taxable person, he has to pay the taxes in advance. So that is what this provision says. Once the tax is paid in advance, there will be a TRN will be allocated to that person, and while applying for the registration itself, the person has to mention till what period the registration he requires the registration. So generally that period will be the period he wants to provide the supply in that state. So he has to provide in the registration form itself what is the period he wants to register himself as a casual taxable person. But anyhow, the period he wants to mention cannot cross 90 days. So it means what? A person can register as a casual taxable person for a period mentioned in the registration form or 90 days, whichever is lower or whichever is earlier. So he can in any case, a person cannot register himself as a casual taxable person more than a period of 90 days, or he can get registered himself for a lesser period. However, the proper officer can allow an extension up to a further period of 90 days, provided he has the reason to believe or any request is made by the person. Clear? So if the proper officer is entrusted with authority to extend the registration up to a further period of 90 days, over and above 90 days, effectively a person cannot get registered himself as a casual taxable person more than 180 days. So that is what this provision says. Next one is ITC is once he registered himself as casual taxable person, then he is eligible to claim ITC on whatever the supplies he has received, and that ITC is available as set off in his output tax liability as well. And when the supply he makes in that particular state and any tax charged on that supply, the recipient of those supply is eligible for ITC as well. So he can pass on the credit to the recipient of supply who has purchased from this casual taxable person. That is also available for a CTD who is called as casual taxable person under the act. So the next category we are going to discuss is non-resident taxable person. Who is called as non-resident taxable person? It is defined in section 2 clause 77. A non-resident taxable person is a person who undertakes supply occasionally, similar to CTD, an NRTD, what I am denoting here is non-resident taxable person is called as NRTD. And NRTD is also undertakes supply only on occasional basis. He is not a regular provider. He does not undertake supply on a regular basis. And he undertakes supply from a state or a union territory where he has no fixed place of business in India. The person does not have a fixed place of residence as well as fixed place of business in India. Clear? He does he undertakes supply only on an occasional basis. He just travels to India from any country outside India. He just travels to India and undertakes certain supply, provide certain supply. Maybe it is a supply in the nature of goods or supply in the nature of services. He can provide that supply. For those time period, he can get registered himself as a non-resident taxable person. Clear? In that case also, there is no threshold limit applicable. He can get registered as a non-resident taxable person, and it is also mandatory for him to register. And such person also is not eligible for to opt for composition levy. Almost whatever the provisions applicable for a casual taxable person, similar provisions is applicable for an NRTD also. For those person also not required to get registered, cannot opt for composition levy. And the application for registration has to be made in form GST-REG-09. In that form, he has to make an application for registration as an NRTD. Payment of taxes to be done in advance. Similar to CTD, NRTD also has to ascertain the tax liability for the supply which he is going to make, and that tax liability has to be paid in advance to the government before application as an NRTD. And registration is again valid for only 90 days, similar to CTD. Almost it is similar. All the provisions of CTD will also be applicable for an NRTD as well. Almost all the provisions. So it means the registration as an NRTD can also be made until the period specified in the application, or 90 days, whichever is earlier. It means the person cannot be registered as an NRTD more than 90 days. Also, the officer here is also entrusted with the power to extend the registration for a further period of 90 days as well, if he deems so. Clear? And similarly, like a casual taxable person, he is eligible to claim ITC, but the only difference is he can claim ITC only on goods which are imported by him. He cannot claim ITC on an indigenous supply. Whatever the goods or services procured locally, he cannot claim any ITC on that. He can claim ITC only on goods that are imported by him. Here it does not say any services he has received, because import of services is liable to reverse charge. Import of goods, for that he can claim an ITC. However, that NRTD can pass on the credit to the recipient of supply. If he supplies goods or services to any other person, such recipient is eligible to take ITC on for any taxes he has paid to the NRTD, because that tax the NRTD will collect from that person will pay back to the government. So that is the reason the recipient of supply is eligible to claim ITC on the supply received from an NRTD. But NRTD cannot claim any ITC other than ITC on goods imported by him. Clear? The next type of person we are going to see is input service distributor. Already in our in another video on input tax credit, we have discussed the concept and provisions relating into input service distributor in detail. What we are going to discuss here is the registration provisions relating to ISD. Registration is compulsory for an ISD. If a person wants to be an ISD, ISD is a person who is a supplier of taxable goods or services, but the supply is not made within the unit, within the same unit. The supply of goods or services would be done from a different unit of the same person, but that unit, most of the cases it would be a corporate office or a head office, where certain services would have been received by him on which the ITC is eligible, but that ITC will not be available to be set off against output tax liability because such person is not an output, they are not engaged in any supply of any output taxable supplies. That is the reason they can avail the ITC and distribute to the other unit for whom the output tax liability is available. So those persons are called as ISD. So in order to become an ISD, the person has to mandatorily register under the GST Act. There is no threshold limit prescribed for those persons, and the registration has to be done in the normal form, in the same form where any other taxpayer will get registered. The same form has to be used by ISD also to get registered. The amount availed as ITC, that is whatever the ITC has availed during the month, and that whatever the amount he has distributed among the other units, has to be reported in the monthly return. The monthly return is in GSTR 6. We have already discussed in our returns chapter as well. GSTR 6, every month it has to be reported, and the return has to be filed on or before 13th of the following month. The details reported in GSTR 6 would be made available to the recipient units. That is, whatever the credits he has distributed to the recipient units and that has been reported under GSTR 6, it will become available to the recipient units to view in GSTR 2A. We already discussed what is the purpose of GSTR 2A. So the recipient units can view the credit distributed by the ISD in their GSTR 2A forms. An ISD cannot avail supplies on which RCM is applicable. An ISD cannot avail supplies on which RCM is applicable because an ISD is not eligible to pay any taxes. They are not eligible to pay any taxes. They can claim only ITC on the supply in the nature of services received by them. If they want to avail any services on which RCM is applicable, they have to mandatorily get registered as a normal taxpayer. They cannot do so by registered as an ISD. They can avail services or supplies on which RCM is applicable only by getting registered as a normal taxpayer only. For them also, we already discussed, there is no threshold limit applicable, so they have to go through the route of RCM normal taxpayer who is required to pay taxes under RCM basis. They will not be called as a person registered under ISD. Now the question here is whether a person can have both registration, whether the person can be an ISD as well as a normal taxpayer who has to pay tax under RCM. The answer to this question is possible. It is possible for a person to hold both the registration. He can be an ISD as well as a normal taxpayer or a normal registered person, but only for the purpose of paying tax under RCM basis. He cannot be a supplier who provides outward supplies. So that is very clear here. Next, if any excess credit is distributed by ISD, for example, the ISD is distributing credits to the respective units. If any credit which is distributed in excess, the same has to be paid back by the recipient units. The excess credit received by the recipient units, they have to pay back the excess amount in cash or along with the interest, and the form they have to use for payment of taxes is form GST DRC03. That is the challan they have to use for payment of paying back the excess credit availed by them because of wrong distribution by the ISD. Clear? So the next provision here is procedure for registration. We are now going to discuss what is the procedure for registration under GST Act itself. So section 25 deals with procedure for registration. Section 25 subsection 1 says what is the time limit for registration. Any person who is liable to get registered under section 22 or under section 24. Section 22 is for threshold limit registration. Section 24 is for a person who has to compulsorily get registered. If a person is liable to get registered under any of these sections, then they have to apply for registration within 30 days. within 30 days of they become liable to get registered, they have to apply to the authorities. Under that subsection, there is a proviso. That proviso says any casual taxable person or a non-resident taxable person, a CTD or an NRTD, has to apply to apply for registration at least 5 days before the commencement of business. If they have to provide any supply of goods or supply of services, and they have to get registered in themselves as either CTD or NRTD, then the application for registration has to be done at least 5 days prior to the date of commencement of supply. So that is what the proviso under this subsection says, and there is an explanation as well under this subsection. It says that supply provided from a territorial waters in India, if the supply is provided from a territorial water inside the ocean, but the waters of the ocean belongs to India, it is called as territorial waters. Up to certain nautical miles inside the ocean, it is agreed that it will belong to the nearest country. For example, certain nautical miles into the ocean nearer to India, it will belong to India, that is called as territorial waters. Once the nautical prescribed nautical mile is called, that is called as high seas. It is an international water. It will not be it will not belong to any countries. So any person who is providing services from the territorial waters, then that person has to get registered. In registered from which state? The state which is very nearby to the state which has a shore. That shore is very nearby to the person who is situated in territorial waters. That is called as the state which is the nearest point. That state he has to get registered. Here, next provision is section 25, subsection 2. Number of registrations within state or union territory. How many registrations are allowed within a state or a union territory? The section says that only single registration is allowed within a state or a union territory. In one state, a person can register only one time. They can register, they cannot hold any multiple registrations. Only single registration is permitted to be provided for a person. However, the proviso says that separate registration can be obtained for different business verticals. If the person conducts business in different business verticals, I will give you an example. A person is a supplier of goods as well as supplier of services. So these two can be considered as a two business vertical. So for the supply of goods, they can obtain a registration separately, and for supply of services, a separate registration can also be obtained. If both these are provided from within a single state, two registrations are allowed if the person is undertaking business in multiple verticals. For each vertical, one single registration is allowed, even though it is done within the same state. It is what provided in the subsection 2. Subsection 3 says voluntary registration. This subsection enables a person to opt to get registered under GST, even though registration is not mandatory for them. He can choose to register under GST law based on the power provided under subsection 3 of section 25. This says that person who are not required to register as per any previous section, they are not mandated to get registered, but on a voluntary basis they can opt to get registered. If they opt to get registered, all the provisions of the act will also become applicable for those persons as well. That is what subsection 3 says. Subsection 4 speaks about distinct persons. It says that a person, if they have more than one registration, if the person is having more than one registration, then multiple registrations can be either within the same state or it can be in multiple states. The person can hold registration in multiple states, or within same state they can hold multiple registration. So whatever the case may be, for each such registration, the other registration will be called as a distinct person only. So in respect of each registration, the other registration will be called as distinct person. So any supplies they make between these two registrations will also be called as a supply only. so the tax has to be charged on that. You cannot claim that I am the same person holding two registrations, so the supply is made between one registration to another, so there will not be any tax liability because of they holding two separate registration, and it is called as two distinct person under the act because of this subsection. The provisions of any supply made between these two, the provisions of the act will become applicable. Then we are going to discuss section subsection 6. Subsection 6 says PAN is mandatory. In order to obtain registration under GST, the person has to mandatorily hold a valid PAN. PAN is a permanent account number that is allotted by the income tax authorities. Income tax authorities will provide will give you a PAN card. So that PAN is mandatory if the person wants to get registered under GST. However, the provision also says that, however, TAN is a tax deduction account number. Tax deduction account number is also provided by the income tax authorities. It is provided for a different purpose. That TAN number is applicable, that can also be used to get registered under GST only for a person who is going to register as a TDS deductor under GST. See, if the person is going to register as a TDS deductor under GST, they can use TAN. If they do not have any PAN, they can use TAN to get registered under GST. But for any other person, the person has to hold a valid PAN. But there is one exception to this by way of a proviso. That proviso says that any NRTD and any non-resident taxable person, if they do not have a PAN, they can register in India as an NRTD by using a valid passport. With their passport, they can register under in India as an NRTD. That is what the proviso says. Then the next subsection is subsection 6A. Subsection 6A has been amended by the CGST Amendment Act 2018. It says that Aadhaar card is only the valid ID proof. Aadhaar card is it is mandatory for the person to get registered. Aadhaar authentication is compulsory for a person to obtain registration. It is only called as an ID proof. ID proof to be used only the Aadhaar card. If Aadhaar is not allotted, if the person is not having any Aadhaar card, then any other alternate ID proof can be submitted. That ID proof will also be prescribed by the government. So that can be used as an ID proof to obtain a registration. In case no such proof is provided, then registration is deemed to be invalid if the person has not provided any ID proof at all. The person has Aadhaar, then Aadhaar card is only to be provided as ID proof. If the person does not have any Aadhaar, it means that the government has not allotted any Aadhaar card to that person, then he can use any other documents which is prescribed by the government as ID proof. If none of the documents is provided as an ID proof while obtaining the registration, then it means what, the registration is deemed to be invalid, and it shall mean that the person is unregistered. They have not got registered at all. It is what that it means. There is another subsection, subsection 6C. It says ID proof for other than individual. See, we discussed that Aadhaar card is mandatory to get registered. If Aadhaar card is only provided for an individual, if the entity is other than individual and the registration has to be taken for other than individual, then what is to be provided? That is answered by subsection 6C. It says that Aadhaar card of the following persons should be used if the entity is the business or the organization is other than individual. Aadhaar card of Karta in the case of HUF, Aadhaar card of Karta has to be used. In the case of a company, Aadhaar card of managing director or a whole time director has to be used. In case of a firm, Aadhaar card of the partner or all the partners has to be used. In the case of any AOP or BOI, AOP means association of persons and BOI means body of individuals. For these types of entities, Aadhaar card of the managing committee members has to be provided. So that those Aadhaar cards will act as an ID proof. Similarly, whatever we saw under section 6A, it says under this also it will become applicable. If any of the persons which we have discussed now, if they do not have any Aadhaar card, then they can use any other ID proof. If no ID proof is provided by these person, then it will be, the registration will become invalid. So they will be called as unregistered person only. Next subsection is subsection 10. Subsection 10 discusses with the due date for acceptance or rejection of application. See, the person has to apply to the officer for registration. The officer cannot keep the application with him for a longer period. There is a due date provided for the officer itself either to accept the application or to reject the application. The due date provided is the officer has to mandatorily either accept the application or reject the application within 3 working days from the date of submission of application. See, if I submit the application today for the purpose of obtaining registration, then the officer has to either accept the application or reject the application within 3 working days. It says not 3 days, it says 3 working days. So if the if today is Saturday, then the 3 days will not start from Sunday, it will start from Monday only. If there are any public holidays falls in middle of that 3 days, then you'll have to add one more day to that. So the 3 days should be a 3 working days. Any holidays in between, it shouldn't be ignored. So clear? So that is subsection 10 here. Subsection 12 says registration is deemed to be granted. It says if no deficiency is communicated within 3 working days. See, for example, I have submitted the application today, and after 3 days, the officer has not given me any answer. They have not even accepted my application, or they have not even rejected my application, or there is no communication at all from the officer. If there is any deficiency, at least the officer has to communicate to me that there are certain deficiency that has to be rectified. If no communication has been received from the officer, it is deemed by this provision, it is deemed that the registration is accepted. The application is accepted and the registration is provided, approved. That is what subsection 12 says. So it is called as deemed to be registered if the officer has not responded within 3 working days from the date of application. Clear? The next provision is section 26. Section 26 says deemed to be registered under this act. It means what? If I have applied for a registration under Central Act, under CGST Act, I have applied. There are 2 jurisdictions we have already discussed. One is central jurisdiction, second one is state jurisdiction or a union territory jurisdiction. Based on my area code, I have to either and the operations, the level of operations I am going to undertake, the authorities have already prescribed it. Is through an internal administrative of the authority, they have already prescribed that whether I will be falling under central registration or under the state registration. If I fall under state registration and I apply for a registration under the state jurisdiction, then it is deemed that I am a registered person under central jurisdiction as well. So I need not apply twice, or I need not apply for once for central jurisdiction and separately for state jurisdiction. If I apply for state jurisdiction, it means it is deemed that I am applied for central jurisdiction as well. Or if I applied for central jurisdiction, it is deemed that I am applied for state jurisdiction as well. So this is what section 26 says. Clear? So almost with this, we have discussed certain provisions of the CGST Act related to registration. That is section 22, section 23 we discussed, section 24 we discussed, 25 also we have discussed, and now we have completed the section 26 as well. Before we go move into next section under registration, we now discuss certain rules under CGST rules relating to registration. Clear? So CGST rules majorly prescribes various forms that is to be used during the process of registration. There are multiple forms already prescribed by the authorities under rules. We can know that any communication is already any communication during this registration is also provided by way of a form here. So there is no separate communication or a separate request letter works here. Whatever the communication has to be made, it is already designed and it has already structured, and it is provided as a separate form itself. We have to use each in the relevant form for any types of process we undertake during this registration. So we will now discuss all the forms one by one and the purpose of it and any due date prescribed for filing that form. So the first form we are going to discuss is form number GST REG 01. See, here I have provided as REG 01, but we have to read it as GST REG 01. REG 01 is the application for registration by every person other than the following persons. This form REG 01 has to be used as a form of application for any person who wants to get registration. It has to be used by every person, but there are certain exceptions to it. Who are all those persons who are not required to use REG 01 is NRTD. NRTD will not register under by an application through REG 01, or a deductor under section 51, that is a tax deductor, or a TDS under GST. Those person also will not use REG 01 for applying for registration. A TCS collector under section 52, he will also not use REG 01, or an OIDR service provider will not use REG 01 for the purpose of applying for registration. This REG 01 has to be submitted within 30 days from the date he has become liable to get registered. We already discussed this under previous section, that is section 25. Within 30 days, if he becomes liable to get registered, within 30 days from the date he is liable to get registered, he has to file an application for registration. That application has to be done in form REG 01, or under section 25 subsection 3, we discussed about a person taking voluntary registration. If a person wants to voluntary register under GST, they can also use form REG 01, and there is no specific due date for that. Whenever he makes the application, he submits the application, that is the date, because it the taking registration is only optional for those person. Clear? That is the purpose of REG 01. Next form is REG 02. REG 02 is nothing but an acknowledgement document. See, once you submit REG 01 online, all the forms which we are speaking here are online forms only. If there is no physical forms, because under GST they have tried to make everything online. So REG 01 is an online application. Once you submit that application, immediately the government will the system itself will generate an acknowledgement. That acknowledgement will be in REG 02. That acknowledgement is also provided as a form that also has a number. That form is called REG 02. That will be provided immediately upon you submit the document REG 01 application. Then next form is REG 03. See, once you submit REG 01, we already discussed that within 3 days the officer has to come back. Either he has to accept the application or he has to reject the application. See, if the application is submitted, and if the officer, upon verifying the application, if they find that the application is either incomplete or the required documents to be submitted is not complete, it means that certain documents are missing for the purpose of registration, in those cases it is called as the application is defective. In deficiency is identified in the application. So in those cases, the officer has to immediately communicate that deficiency to the applicant. That deficiency should be communicated in REG 03. The communication of deficiency in the application has to be done in REG 03 by the officer. When it has to be done? Within 3 working days from the date of submission of REG 01. Within 3 working days, the officer has to communicate the deficiency to the applicant in REG 03. Once the deficiency is communicated to the applicant in REG 03, then the application, the applicant has to respond to the deficiency, right? See, once you there is a communication you have received from the department that there is a deficiency in your application, kindly rectify. The taxpayer or the applicant has to rectify that deficiency. In order to rectify the deficiency, the applicant has to use the form called REG04. So the REG04 has to be used by the applicant to clarify or rectify the deficiency, and that has to be submitted online. When it has to be submitted? It has to be submitted within 7 working days from the date of receipt of deficiency. See, the officer has sent you the form called GST REG03, and you have received that form today. Within 7 working days from today, the person has to respond to that form. Respond in the nature of either clarifying or rectifying the deficiency. That has to be, the response has to be done in REG04. Clear? So the next form we are going to discuss is REG05. See, if the officer, after receiving the clarification or rectification from the applicant in REG04, still the officer is not satisfied with the documents or the information provided by the applicant, then the officer can reject the application. They can deny the approval of registration. If the officer wants to reject the application or deny the registration, it has to be done in by way of an order. The officer has to pass a rejection order. That rejection order has to be passed in GST REG05. That is the form the officer has to use for the purpose of passing a rejection order. When this rejection can be done, it has to be done within 7 working days from the date of receipt of clarification or a rectification of deficiency from the applicant. See, the applicant has to respond to the deficiency in REG04, and the response is submitted today. From that date, within 7 working days, the officer has to either grant registration, accept the deficiency and grant registration, or if he feels that the registration cannot be granted, then he has to reject the application within 7 working days. So the rejection has to be made in REG05. See, if the officer doesn't want to reject, if the officer wants to approve the registration, if he feels that all the documents are perfectly fine and he wants to approve the registration, then he has to approve the registration through REG06. Rejection is to be done in REG05, and approval of registration has to be done in REG06. That REG06 is called a certificate of registration. Certificate of registration has to be done by the officer. See, if in the case of registration where the officer has not come back or he has not acted within the due date, within the timeline provided by the Act, then it is called as deemed registration. In the case of deemed registration, then also this REG06 will be provided by the officer. When this deemed registration will work, we already saw that if we file REG01, the officer has to come back within 3 working days. If he has not come back within 3 working days, it is deemed to be the registration is granted. In that case, it will directly go to REG06. Certificate of registration will be issued. Or the officer has come back with REG03 with certain deficiency, and we have responded within 7 working days in order to rectify the deficiency or for a clarification. But after submission of this REG04, the officer has to respond within 7 working days if he wants to reject the application. If he has not responded within 7 working days, it means that the registration is deemed to be granted. The officer has to mandatorily issue a certificate in GST REG06. REG06 is very important. It is called as registration certificate. So the next form is REG07. REG07 is to be used by the person who deduct tax under section 51. Who is a TDS deductor under section 51 of GST Act, they have to apply for registration using form REG07. When it has to be filed? When he he gets liable to get registered, on that immediately he has to file this form REG07. Once he has filed REG07, then the officer, whatever the forms which you have seen before, for example, other than REG01, all other forms will become applicable for this REG07 also. This REG07 only replaces REG01. All other forms are intact for the officer. Clear? So the registration in this case also will be provided in REG06 only. There is no separate form for certificate of registration for a TDS deductor. Clear? The next form is REG08. In case of registration as deductor or collector is granted and found to be not eligible, not liable to be later on. See, for example, the officer has granted the registration in GST 06. For whom? For a tax deductor or a collector. The tax deductor or collector has to be used form. The application for registration for a tax deductor or collector is for GST REG 07. If the application is made and the officer also granted the registration under by issuing a form called REG 06, later on if the officer feels or comes to know that the particular person is no longer liable to get registration, then in that case he will deny the registration, the cancellation. He will cancel the registration through issue of form REG 08. That is what the form the officer will use to cancel the registration. This is applicable only for a deductor or collector. It is not applicable for a normal person, normal registered person. The next form we are going to discuss is REG 09. REG 09 is application by a non-resident taxable person has to apply for registration by submitting the form called REG 09, and this REG 09 has to be submitted at least 5 days before the commencement of business. So the application has to accompany with a self-attested copy of a passport, because we already discussed that a non-resident taxable person has to mandatorily submit a copy of his passport in order to obtain the registration. The submission of PAN is not mandatory for a NRTD, so that has to be done in REG 09. Next form is REG 10, REG 10 is to be used by the OIDR service provider. OIDR service provider has to apply for registration in REG 10. There is no due date specified by the rules here. So whenever he becomes liable to get registered, immediately he has to apply for the registration within in REG 10. Clear? So the next form is form REG 11. REG 11 is for an application for request for extension of period of operation by a CTD or NRTD. We already discussed that for a CTD or NRTD, the maximum time they can obtain registration is only 90 days. But the proper officer has authority to extend the registration for a further period of 90 days. If the taxpayer or if the CTD or an NRTD wants to request for an extension of time for the registration, then they have to file a request application in REG 11. This REG 11 has to be filed before the expiry of the existing registration. They cannot file after the existing registration has been expired. If their existing registration is expired, they have to only use the normal form. They cannot seek for an extension of registration after the expiry of the current registration. Clear? The next form we are going to discuss is REG 12. REG 12 is order by officer to register on a temporary basis. REG 12 is an order. It is an order issued by the officer, and the officer registers the person on a temporary basis. Why he has registered? Because the person is the person is liable to be registered, but he has not registered, and the officer through in the course of search or any inquiry or any inspection, he has found that the person is liable to get registered, but he has not got registered. In that case, the officer will issue an order in REG 12. That order is for the temporary registration of that person. Once that order is issued, the person will become a registered person. They have to pay tax on the supplies. Once this order is received, the person has to file a application for registration. They have to register himself in the normal mode within a period of 90 days from the date of receipt of this order. So that is what this REG12 is used for. So clear, these are all almost the forms which we have seen, but the forms for registration does not stop with here. There are some more forms also which we will be discussing in our future slides. Before that, we will just discuss certain other points which is provided in rules, in under CGST rules. The first point is furnishing of bank account details. Rule 10A of CGST rule says the person who has applied for registration and for whom the registration is granted, within 45 days from the date of grant of registration, they have to furnish the bank account details. The bank account details has to be furnished to the authorities within 45 days from the date of grant of registration. That's what Rule 10A says. Then the next rule is Rule 11. Rule 11 says separate registration for multiple place of business within a state or union territory. We already saw that a person can hold only one registration in a state. But if a person operates with more than one business vertical, for each business vertical they can obtain a separate registration. But under Rule 11 says a person can hold multiple registration within the same state itself. Separate registration shall be granted for persons operated from more than one place within the same state. See, we saw that a person can have only one registration in one state, but if the person is operating with more than one business vertical, for each business vertical they can have a separate registration. But if the person is operating from more than one place in the same state, in that case also for each place of business they can obtain a separate registration. That is also allowed under Rule 11. Clear? So that is what this rule says. Such separately registered place shall pay tax and issue invoice for any supplies made to such other place where separate registration is obtained. I will give you an example. I am a supplier and I supply goods from Tamil Nadu. In Tamil Nadu, I have place of business in Chennai as well as in Madurai. I have two places I am operating in. In for those two places, even though it is within the same state, I can obtain two separate registration. I can obtain a separate registration for my business in Chennai as well as for my business in Madurai, even though both the business are falling under the same business vertical. Even in that case, if I have two separate place of business, for each separate place of business I can obtain a separate registration. If I obtain a separate registration for each place, then whatever the supply I make between these two places, that will be called as a normal supply between distinct persons, and tax has to be charged on that supply as well. Clear? It will not be called as an inter-unit transfer, it will be called as a supply between distinct persons, because for each registration the person is called as a distinct person. So the next rule we are going to discuss here is rule number 18. Rule number 18 says display of a registration certificate or a GSTN on the board. Because of this rule, it mandates the registered person to display the GST certificate. GST certificate in REG06, which we discussed now. That certificate has to be displayed in a prominent place, in the place of business, in every place of business. For example, I have two place of businesses under single registration. In each place of businesses, I need to display maybe as I can paste it in a wall, or I can even frame it and hang it in my office. So however I can it is possible I can do, but it has to be done in a prominent place. It cannot be done in some remote place within the premises. I cannot do it where it is not at all visible. So it has to be done in a prominent place where it is most commonly visible for anyone. So that is very much important. That is mandated by this rule 18. So the next point is the GST number. Whatever the GST number I have, GST ID, that GST ID has to be displayed in my entry board, whatever the board or hoarding I have fixed in my entry to my office, entry door, there I have to paste the GST number. That is also mandatory. That has to be done in all the place of business under single registration. If I have two places where I operate business, on all the two places, at the entry point, whatever the board I have, in that board the GST number also should be included, should be displayed. That is what rule 18 says. So the next provision here is section 28. Section 28 speaks with any amendment to the registration. If I have to do any amendment to the registration, then the provisions of section 28 has to be followed. Section 28 subsection 1 says, if there is any change of information to be furnished, for example, I have furnished certain information, based on that information I have already obtained the registration, but in future, in the later point of time, if any of the information is changed, for example, I have applied with some address as a place of business, in future if I shift my office from one place to another, it means my address has already changed. In those cases, it is called, I have to amend my registration. That is called as amendment of registration. So any change of information or documents that has already been supplied while I obtained the registration initially, and that is changed or altered now, that is, there is a change in that, in that case it has to be informed to the officer through filing of a form called GST REG 14. We already saw till REG 13. This, the form used to be used here is REG 14. That has to be done within 15 days of change. If my address has changed today, within next 15 days I have to file a form called REG 14. That form is for furnishing the change of furnishing the information about the change of address to the proper officer. Clear? So then the next point says, if the change of information, if the amendment is related to any of the following, and if it does not warrant cancellation, the change or the amendment is for any of the following aspects, the three aspects provided in the below, and it is also does not warrant any cancellation of registration, in that case then the officer has to either approve or reject the amendment by way of issue by of an order. They have to, the officer has to accept or reject the application, amendment application, in form GST REG 15 within 15 days from the date of application. 15 days time period is provided. So within 15 days the officer has to either approve or reject, where if the change of if the amendment relates to any of these three categories, and it does not also not warrant, it does not also lead to any cancellation. What are all those three categories? If there is any change in legal name of business, my name of business has been changed. Second, if there is any change in address of any place of business, I have one or two places already provided and any change in address is there, then in that case that will also be coming under this category. Next is change in management of the business entity. For example, I have already registered as a sole proprietor, then it is changed. For example, I have I am a partnership firm and I have registered with four partners. In that four partners, I have already provided the ID proof of that four partners. Now one partner has changed. I have one partner has been removed. He has retired from the firm. Now I am going to continue with only three partners. So this is called, this warrants an amendment in the registration. So for that type of amendment, I have to apply in GST REG 14. This point says, these types of amendments requires an approval or a rejection. It means what, the officer will verify the amendment in these cases, and it has to be approved or accepted or rejected. In the case of acceptance or rejection, it is to be communicated through an order under REG 15 within 15 days from the date of application. If the change relates to any other information other than above, see the three information we have provided, if there are any other information that I am going to change, in those cases then the change is deemed to be immediately accepted. See, there is no action required from the officer side. Once you submit the form REG 14, if you have, once you submitted, immediately it is deemed to be accepted by the authorities. It is, the effect of change takes place immediately. there is no requisition from the department to either accept it or reject it if the amendment is not for these three cases. So clear? The next point is, if the change relates to change in legal name or address for one state. See, for example, the change relates to change in legal name or the change relates to change in address that is to be done in one state, then such change is deemed to be applicable for all the registration under the same PAN. And the same PAN, if I have multiple registrations in two different states and if I apply for a change in one state, it is deemed to be applicable for the registration in the other state also under the same PAN. So that is what this point says. The next point says, where the change results in the change of PAN number, the PAN number itself is changed, then the applicant shall apply for a fresh registration only. It means what? If my PAN number has all changed, the existing registration is stand to be cancelled. It is liable to be cancelled. I have to apply for a fresh registration only. What could be the circumstance that my registration could change? See, for example, I am a partnership firm, existing partnership firm. I convert myself into a company. The partnership firm is converted into a company. In that case, the PAN number will mandatory change because the PAN number for a partnership firm is different from a PAN number of a company. So if that leads to a change in PAN number, then we have already obtained the registration based on the existing PAN number only. If that PAN number is changed, then whatever the registration I have under GST, that will become invalid. That will lead to liable for cancellation of the existing registration. And for the new PAN number, the person has to mandatorily apply for a fresh registration only. That cannot be done through by way of an amendment. They cannot use form REG14 for such type of cases. Next point says, the proper officer shall not reject an application without providing a reasonable opportunity to be heard. See, wherever we have seen that the proper officer has a discretion either to accept it or reject it, in those cases, if the officer wants to reject the application, then that such rejection can be made only after providing an opportunity to the applicant to be heard. After providing an opportunity to be heard from the applicant, it means what? The officer has to provide an opportunity to the applicant to explain his situation. He can explain the reasons for any violation or whatever the case may be. The opportunity to be provided before taking action of rejection, that is called as principles of natural justice. It is a natural the natural right vested with which the applicant has. So because of that natural justice, the officer has to provide an opportunity. If the officer wants to accept the registration, then this provision will not apply. If the officer wants to reject the application, then only this principle of natural justice will come into force. So the next point is, any amendment as per SGST or UTGST law shall be deemed to be an amendment under this law also. See, if I have a registration under state jurisdiction, then if I make any amendment in state jurisdiction, then it is deemed to be amended under central jurisdiction also, because we already discussed that if I apply for a registration in state jurisdiction, it is deemed to be applied under central jurisdiction also. Similarly, if I apply for any amendment in state jurisdiction, it is deemed that the amendment has been taken effect under central jurisdiction also. So the next point is, if proper officer does not take any action on the application. See, if the proper officer, after this application is made for amendment, if he has not taken any action within a period of 15 days, then it is deemed to be approved. It means that the amendment is accepted by the officer. It is deemed that the amendment has taken place. It has been accepted by the authorities if the officer does not take any action within 15 days. So that's what this point says. This is about the amendment of registration, the provisions in the CGST Act. Okay, we have CGST Act as well as the CGST rules also. CGST rules related to amendment of registration is also covered under this slide. So the next point we are going to discuss now is cancellation of registration. So cancellation of registration is discussed in provisions of section 29. Section 29 subsection 1 says the officer may either on his own motion or application from a registered person or a legal heir in case of the registered person is died can proceed to cancel the registration. So this says what? A registered person can apply for cancellation of a registration, that is one, or the proper officer on his own motion can also cancel the registration, or if the registered person has died, then the legal representative or the legal heir of the registered person can apply for a cancellation. Once it is done, then the cancellation of registration can be made by the officer. The cancellation of registration cannot be applied by the registered person on his own motion. It can be applied only in the following circumstances. Not for any reason the person can cancel the registration. See, for example, it is the option for the for any person to apply for registration, but the same option is not provided for the person. Whenever he wants to apply, he can apply for registration. Whenever he wants to cancel the registration, he can cancel the registration. It's not provided by the act. The option is provided for the open option is provided for any person to apply for registration, but there is no open option provided for any person to apply for a cancellation of registration. If the cancellation of registration is to be applied by the registered person, it can be applied only in the following circumstances. What are those circumstances? First, if the business he has been doing, it has been discontinued or transferred to some other person. See, he is a sole proprietor and he was doing business under his name, and he has got the registration from his personal PAN. At some point of time, if the particular person has transferred the business to some other person, he has given away his business to some other person, then in that case, he cannot ask the another person to carry on the business with the registration of this person. So in that case, this person can apply for a cancellation of registration, and the other person who has got the business, they can apply for a fresh registration with his own PAN. So in that cases, if the business is discontinued or if it is transferred to some other person, this person can apply for a cancellation of registration. Then the second scenario is if the change in the constitution of business, we already discussed that. If I was a partnership firm and I have been converted into a company, then it means whatever the PAN I was holding under a firm, it will get cancelled. Once the PAN get cancelled, immediately the GSTN will also become invalid. In those cases, I can apply for a cancellation of that existing GST registration, and for the new entity, for the company, I have to separately apply for a registration. In those case, I can apply for the cancellation of the existing registration. Then the third scenario is taxable person no longer liable to be registered. See, I have applied for registration because I have become liable to get registered. Under section 22 or under section 24, we already discussed the scenarios where I have to get registered myself under GST Act. I have not registered myself on a voluntary basis. It is a mandatory registration I have done. But now I am no longer liable to get registered. Whatever the conditions I was satisfying before, it is not satisfying now. In those cases, I am not no longer required to be registered. In those cases, I can apply for a cancellation of registration. But this case is not applicable for a voluntary registration. If I have voluntarily taken the registration, it means that I cannot cancel the registration, because I have choose to be inside the act. I can never come back to the act. Come outside of the act because I no longer wants to be a registered person. Clear? This remedy is not provided. But if the act has mandated you to get registered, then it also provides you with the relief that if you do not satisfy the condition, no longer you satisfy that condition, you can come out of the provisions of the act. Then you can apply for a cancellation and come out of the GST law. Okay, the next point is the application for cancellation by taxpayer has to be made in form GST REG 16. REG 16 is the form and that has to be used for applying for the cancellation. that cancellation has to be applied within 30 days from the date of occurring of event warranting cancellation. We saw that there are three scenarios where it warrants for a cancellation. We can apply for a cancellation. In those scenarios, when the event has happened which leads to the cancellation of registration, the application for cancellation has to be applied within 30 days from the date of occurring of that event. Clear? And the application form for that is form GST REG 1616. Clear? The next section is subsection 2. Section 29 subsection 2 says cancellation by the officer. Subsection 1 says cancellation by the officer on his own motion or through the application by the registered person. But here it is the cancellation is by the officer on his own motion only. The application, the applicant or the registered person cannot apply for cancellation under this subsection. This subsection reads as follows: the officer may cancel the registration on happening of the following event from such date as specified by the officer, and that cancellation can be done only after giving an opportunity to be heard. See, under previous subsection there is no requirement for opportunity to be heard because the cancellation is applied by the taxable person only. So if the officer is cancelling that registration, in that case there is no requirement follow the principle of natural justice. But here the officer on his own motion, he is going to cancel the registration. In that case, he can cancel the registration only after giving a due opportunity for the taxpayer to be heard. So what are all those scenarios where the officer can cancel the registration? This clause A says the person has contravened any of the provisions of the act or the rules. If the person has contravened the provisions of the act or rules, the officer may cancel his registration. Second is, if the composition taxpayer does not file his returns for a consecutive 3 tax periods. See, we already know that the taxpayer has to file a quarterly return. If the taxpayer does not file his returns for 3 consecutive quarters, it says consecutive quarters. If he has filed for this quarter and next quarter he has not filed, and the next quarter he filed, it means that he has not, non-filing is not for 3 consecutive quarters. If it is the non-filing is for 3 consecutive quarters, then the officer may proceed to cancel his registration. So the next point is, if the normal taxpayer has not filed his returns for a consecutive period of 6 tax periods. In case of composition taxpayer, it is 3 tax periods. For a normal taxpayer, it is a 6 tax periods, because normal taxpayer files returns on a monthly basis. If the monthly returns are not filed for 6 months, then the officer may proceed to cancel the registration. The next point is, person taken voluntary registration has not commenced the business within 6 months. I have taken a registration on voluntary basis, but after taking the registration, I have not commenced the business for the next 6 months. In that case, the officer may proceed to cancel my registration. Then the next point is, registration obtained by way of fraud or willful misstatement or by suppression of some facts. The registration is obtained by any of these modes, then the officer, after he finds that fraud or a misstatement, he can proceed to cancel such registration. That is what provided under section 29 subsection 2. There is a rule here, rule 21 says that cancellation in certain other cases also provided under rule 21. Rule 21 says does not conduct business from declared place of business. See, I have provided my place of business as some place, but I am not conducting my business in that place. I am conducting my business in some other places, or that the place where I am conducting my business is not declared in the GST, in the registration. In those cases, the officer may cancel my registration. The next is, the taxpayer has issued invoice or bill without making any supplies. We already know that the invoice or bill can be issued only after the supply is over. If the bill or invoice is issued before the supply has got over, then in those cases the registration is liable to be cancelled. Next point is, violating the provisions of section 171. What does section 171 says? It says about the anti-profiteering measures. it is the anti-profiteering measures. If the person has violated those provisions, in those cases the registration would be cancelled. We'll just tell you what is anti-profiteering measure. See, for example, I am making a supply of certain goods, and the goods are like the rate applicable for that goods is 18%. So my price, the price I charge to the end customer is 1200 rupees, and that 1200 rupees is inclusive of GST, and the rate of GST is 18%. Clear? And I have been charging that price for so many days. But on one fine day, what has happened, the department has come up with certain notification, and it says that the goods which I am supplying, the rate for that goods has reduced from 18% to 5%. Clear? So 18% has become 5% for my goods. But what I am doing, I am not giving that benefit to the end customer. To that extent, I have to reduce my price also, right? I cannot find profit on such reduction by the government. So I have to reduce my price also to the extent how much the tax rate has been reduced on that particular product. If I am not doing that, I want to earn profit for to that extent also. So in that case, the department restricts for that person to earn such profit. It is called as anti-profiteering measures. So in those cases, if that provisions are violated by the person, then the registration will become cancelled. Then the next one is violation of rule 10A. We just now discussed what is rule 10A. The person has to furnish the bank account details within 45 days from the date of grant of registration. If the person has failed to furnish the bank details within 45 days, then the registration has been the grant registration granted to him will liable to become cancelled. So that is what rule 21 says about cancellation of registration. Then the next section is section 29 subsection 3. Liability to pay taxes will be valid only even after the registration is cancelled. It doesn't mean that the tax liability to be paid by the taxpayer will become invalid. It because of this subsection, it says that whatever the tax payable by the taxpayer, it is valid only. It stands to be valid, and they have to pay the taxes even though the registration is cancelled. In any scenarios, even though the registration is cancelled on the application by the applicant, by the taxpayer, or through the officer, suo moto mode of officer, in any of the case, whatever the tax is liable to be paid, that has to be paid only. Cancellation does not affect the liability to pay taxes or discharge of any duties of the act that has also to be followed even though the cancellation is done. Till what date it has to be done is, if any tax liability that has arisen prior to the date of cancellation, that has to be paid. After the date of cancellation, it means that the registration is cancelled, there is no tax liability on that. So till the date of cancellation, whatever the tax you have already charged in the invoice and it is collected, it has to be paid to the government. Whether or not such liability is ascertained, see, you cannot say that I do not know about the liability at that point of time. I have ascertained my tax liability only after the date of cancellation. Even in those cases, if it relates to the period before the cancellation date, the tax amount of that has to be paid to the government. That is what subsection 3 says. Next one is subsection 5. Subsection 5 says final payment of liability. The person shall pay an amount. Final payment of liability is that whatever the below liability computation of liability in by applying the following provisions, that has to be paid by the registered person. It is called as a final payment of liability. From then he does not have any liability at all to the government to pay any taxes. What is that liability? The person shall pay an amount equivalent to an amount of ITC, on the amount of ITC on the inputs held in stock in trade. Okay, ITC on the amount on the inputs held in stock in trade, either by way of raw material or work in progress or finished goods on the date of cancellation. Okay, on the date of cancellation, whatever the inputs he has held in stock in trade and the ITC availed on those inputs, that has to be pay to the government. Okay, that is one. Second one is, are the output tax payable on such goods? See, if the goods are in the nature of finished goods and I have to make that supply of that finished goods, on making supply of that goods, what if the tax amount, whatever the tax amount is, will become payable, that amount I have to take, or the amount of ITC I have availed on such goods, I have to compare these two, and whichever is higher among these two, I have to pay to the government as a final liability. That is one scenario. Second one is, this is for in respect to inputs. In respect to capital goods, I have to again compute two amounts. What are those two amounts? The amount number one is ITC I have availed on purchase of such capital goods. I have availed ITC, and that ITC I have to depreciate, I have to reduce it at the rate of 5% for every quarter. Every quarter of usage of that capital goods in my business, I have to reduce 5% and after the reduction is done till the date of cancellation, from the date of purchase, after this reduction, whatever is the balance ITC, that is amount one. Or second one is the transaction value of the capital goods. The capital goods has to be sold on that date. The transaction value of such capital goods as determined under section 15. Section 15 is the valuation chapter. We have a video already relating to valuation chapter, that is under section 15. If you want to access the video on valuation chapter, kindly refer to the link which is flashed on the above screen. Okay, that is amount number two. So tax calculated on such transaction value, that is amount number two. We have to compare these two amounts. Higher of these two amounts has to be paid. Okay, the payment can be done either by way of reversal of ITC. If the sufficient ITC is available in your electronic credit ledger, you have to reverse the amount of electronic credit ledger to this extent. If the amount is not sufficient, then whatever the amount available in your electronic credit ledger, that has to be reversed, and any excess amount which is over and above which is shortage of this amount, that shortfall amount has to be paid by way of cash in the electronic cash ledger. So this amounts has to be somewhat paid. For example, if the electronic credit ledger has sufficient amounts and you make the reversal, and if there are any balance amount even after the reversal of this amount, if there are any balance credit available in electronic credit ledger, that has to be lapsed. You no longer have a right to that credit ledger, input tax credit on that. Clear? That's what subsection 3 says. And we are now going to discuss the relevant rules related to cancellation of registration. Rule number 21A, it says that suspension of registration. Registration is deemed to be suspended from date of application of cancellation till the date of grant of order of cancellation. For example, I have applied for cancellation today and it takes some time for the officer, which we have already discussed that within certain days the officer has to either accept the application or reject the application. If the till that date, from the date I have applied for the cancellation till the date the cancellation already provided by the authorities, till that date my registration is stand suspended. It means that the my registration is suspended for that period of time. During that period of time, the person shall not make any supply at all. He shall not make any supply, or he shall not make any supply and charge tax on that. And the return is also not required to be filed during that period where the registration is being suspended. That is rule 21A. Next is rule 22. Rule 22 says procedure for cancellation of registration by the proper officer. See, we already discussed under section 29 subsection 2, the proper officer may cancel the registration if any of the events which we have already discussed in that subsection, if any of the event has happened, the officer may cancel the registration. If the officer wants to cancel the registration, the following procedures has to be followed by the officer. The officer shall first issue a show cause notice in form GST REG 17. A show cause notice has to be issued before proceeding to cancellation of registration. That is called opportunity of being heard. We already discussed that he has to provide an opportunity of being heard before proceeding to cancellation. That opportunity of being heard should be given by way of show cause notice in form REG 17. The person has to respond to that said show cause notice within 7 working days. show cause notice is received by the person, from the date of receipt of the notice, within 7 working days he has to respond to the notice. He can give his own stand, whatever he wants to say on that notice, he can respond to it. That response has to be provided in form GST REG 18. Okay, once the response is provided, the order of cancellation has to be issued within 30 days from the date of application by the taxpayer, or response to show cause notice in form REG, response to show cause notice. See, the officer, either on receipt of the application within 30 days, or if he has issued a show cause notice and the person has responded to the show cause notice within 7 days from the date of receipt of the notice, within 30 days he has to provide the order of cancellation. That order of cancellation has to be provided in form GST REG 19. If the response to show cause notice is found satisfactory, the officer shall drop the proceedings and intimate the same to the taxpayer in form GST REG 20. See, REG 19 is for the order of cancellation. GST REG 20 is if the response provided by the taxpayer is satisfactory for the officer, then the officer has to drop the cancellation proceedings. Once the officer drops the cancellation proceedings, that has to be intimated to the taxpayer by way of a form called form GST REG 20. So clear. So the next one, the next topic now we are going to discuss is revocation of cancellation. See, once the officer has cancelled my registration, I can apply for revocation of such cancellation. The provisions relating to that is discussed in section 30 of CGST Act. Section 30 subsection 1 says application for revocation of cancellation. A person whose registration is cancelled by the proper officer on his own motion. This section clearly says that cancellation of registration under section 29 subsection 2, where the officer in his own motion he has cancelled the registration. This section, this revocation application does not apply to a case where the cancellation has been done from the application from the taxpayer. If the taxpayer has applied for the cancellation, he cannot change his mind and go for application of revocation of such cancellation. If he has changed the mind in the later point of time, then he has to go for a fresh registration only. He cannot go for the revocation of cancellation. This revocation of cancellation is applicable only where the proper officer on his own motion has cancelled the registration. In those cases, the applicant has a remedy by way of filing an application called revocation of cancellation. So may apply to such officer an application to revoke such cancellation. That application has to be made within 30 days from the date of service of cancellation order. We already saw that the cancellation order will be served in GST REG 19. Once you receive that GST REG 19 from the officer, which is cancellation order, within 30 days from the date of receipt of such order, you have to file a revocation application. If the 30 days has crossed, then the officer may accept delay. The officer may condone the delay if there is a proper justification for the delay, but otherwise the revocation application has to be filed within 30 days from the date of cancellation order. It is not from the date of the order, it is from the date of the receipt of such order by the taxpayer. So the date 30 days starts from the date the order is received by the taxpayer. It is not the date the order is passed by the officer. So that we have to be very clear on that part. So the next is subsection 2. Subsection 2 is the action of the officer on receipt of the revocation application. If I have applied for a revocation application, then the officer may either revoke the cancellation. If he finds if he is satisfied with that application, he can revoke the cancellation, or he may canceling, or he can reject the application also. If he is not satisfied with that revocation application, he can even reject the application. But the rejection of application, as we have already discussed, it can be done only after giving an opportunity to be heard. After following the principles of natural justice, then only he can reject the application of revocation. Otherwise, he cannot reject the application, but he can accept the application of revocation and he can revoke the cancellation. Here, then there is a rules here. CGST rule 23 provides the procedure relating to application of revocation. Application of revocation has to be done in form GST REG 21. We saw till REG 20, now is form REG 21. This is for application of revocation of cancellation. If the cancellation is for non-filing of returns, we saw that for a composition taxpayer, if return is not filed for 3 consecutive tax periods, or for normal taxpayer, if the return is not filed for 6 consecutive tax periods, then the officer may cancel the registration. If the registration is cancelled for any of these 2 reasons, then the application of revocation can be filed only after filing the pending returns. See, whatever the returns we have not filed, that because of that the registration is cancelled, we can apply for the revocation application only after filing the pending returns. We cannot directly go and file the revocation application unless we rectify that mistake of ours. Clear? That is what the Act says. The order of revocation by the officer has to be provided in GST REG 22. Revocation order has to be provided in REG 22. That has to be provided within 30 days from the date of receipt of application. See, I apply to the officer in REG 21. On receipt of that REG 21, the officer has to either revoke the cancellation or he can reject the application. If he is revoking the cancellation, that has to be done within 30 days and he has to pass a revocation order. That revocation order has to be passed in GST REG 22. Rejection of the said application to be done in form GST REG 05. See, if he wants to reject that application, if he wants to reject that revocation application, that has to be done in GST REG 05. Okay, before rejecting the application, the officer has to issue a show cause notice. I told you that the officer has to provide an opportunity of being heard, principles of natural justice. That opportunity of being heard has to be done by way of issuing a show cause notice. That show cause notice has to be issued in form GST REG 23. And after receiving that show cause notice from the officer, the taxpayer has to respond to that show cause notice. He can put forth whatever the stand he has. So that response to the show cause notice has to be done within 7 working days from the date of receipt of the show cause notice. That response has to be done in form GST REG 24. Okay, the show cause notice in REG 23 and the response to the show cause notice has to be done in REG 24. Then the officer shall take an action on the said response within 30 days from the date of receipt of the response. So the officer has to take an action of either revoking the application or rejecting the application, revoking the cancellation or rejecting the application within 30 days from the date of receipt of the response from the taxpayer after the show cause notice is issued. Clear? That is what the provisions relating to revocation of cancellation of registration. So with this, I think we have already almost discussed every part of provisions relating to registration under GST. We have discussed registration under GST. We have discussed the provisions relating to amendment, any amendment in our registration. We also discussed the provisions relating to cancellation of registration. And we also discussed the remedy available to the taxpayer once the registration is cancelled by way of filing a revocation application. So all these aspects we have discussed, which is from the CGST Act as well as the relevant rules of it and the procedure, whatever the forms to be used, everything has been discussed in this video. So we will meet in any other video and in our next chapter and our next video. So kindly subscribe to the channel if you want to get a notification whenever any new video is being uploaded. Clear? We'll meet in our next video. Thank you.